that the doctor was going to have me do estrogen priming, and I asked if you guys were interested in knowing more, and you said yes, so here is that video. Thanks for clicking on Simply Tanika. I am Tanika. If you are new here, welcome. Hit that subscribe button. Let's hang out a while. If you are returning, welcome back. Let's get those babies, ladies. I see the crystal raindrops fall and the beauty. Hi, ladies. How are you? I've missed you. This is my first video since coming back from vacation. I wanted to hop on here and talk to you guys about estrogen priming. I had mentioned in one of the videos before I went on vacation that the doctor was going to have me do estrogen priming, and I asked if you guys were interested in knowing more, and you said yes, so here is that video. So first of all, I have a history of a very fluctuating FSH, which is follicle stimulating hormone. It has ranged from 50.1, that was the highest it was, all the way down to 7.7 in the last 7 cycles that I have been attempting to conceive. So I'm an excellent candidate for estrogen priming. I also have a low AMH. I was tested twice for my AMH. The first time it was 0.387, and the second time I believe it was 0.37. So just right around 0.4 is what it has been. And that they were tested about 12 months apart. So I'm a good candidate because follicle stimulating hormone, if it's too high, as we learned in my other cycle, which I'll link over here, my body will not respond to stimulation. So two cycles ago, my FSH was at 22 and I did not respond to the letrozole. And then there was another time when it was 50.1 at the old RE where she just canceled the cycle straight away. So we don't want to be in a situation where I'm doing IVF and I don't respond to the medicine or have a poor response. So the point of the estrogen priming is to give me a better shot of responding well and having more follicles that are mature and or that have mature eggs and also that are good quality. So what is estrogen priming? Basically, we always talk about hormones like follicle stimulating hormones and luteinizing hormone. The one we don't really talk about is inhibin, and it happens in the second half of our cycle, so when we're in our luteal phase, and inhibin does just what it kind of sounds like it does. It inhibits other hormones. So it inhibits the follicle stimulating hormone from going up too fast, which gives me or anyone else a poor response. And so if the inhibin decreases as we age, which we know that it does, then that means it leaves the follicle stimulating hormone kind of out of check, and the follicle stimulating hormone will just start to rise on its own, which it'll start to rise in the luteal phase, so that by the time I do that cycle day two or cycle day three blood work in the next cycle, it's already sky high because the inhibin wasn't high enough to stop it from kind of being out of whack. So inhibin and estrogen, there's always a ratio with our hormones. Inhibin and estrogen typically are lower in women with poor responses as we get older. It's no surprise, right? We don't expect like my AMH to be really high. I'm 47. It would be weird if I had a really high AMH because that means my egg reserve would still be really high. We wouldn't expect me to have the same egg reserve as a 36-year-old in the same way we wouldn't expect the 36-year-old to have the same egg reserve as a 26-year-old, right? That makes sense. So I'm older. My inhibin and my estrogen are lower, typically, in the second phase of my cycle. So estrogen priming is helping to offset that. So basically, on cycle day 21, or 7 days post-ovulation, 7 DPO, I will go in, which in this cycle is tomorrow, as I'm recording this. And so they will test my blood work and see where I am. They're going to look at my estrogen. They're going to look at my follicle-stimulating hormone. If everything comes back within range, then they will start me on an estrogen patch. Although this cycle, I don't know if they will because I have to have that polyp removed, but let's just say in the cycle that I'm the preceding cycle before IVF meds. If everything comes back normal on cycle day 21, they will have me start with the estrogen patch, which is the Estrace patch. It's like 0.5 milligrams. I put it on one side for 2 days, and then the next 48-hour cycle, I take another one and put it on the other side, remove the first one. Does that make sense? And so why, how does that help overall? Basically, the estrogen is increasing the estrogen in my body. So my body will respond like it's its own estrogen. That will increase my inhibin, which will then inhibit my follicle stimulating hormone from going too high, so that it should be within range by cycle day 2 or cycle day 3 of the following cycle, the subsequent cycle, when I am being prepped for the meds. Does that make sense? So at the end of the day, we want to make sure those 7 days or 7 to 13, depending on how long the luteal phase is, that estrogen is in the body is primed. At the end of it, the result should be that I have more follicles that are all developing at the same pace and that they're all of higher quality. The downside, and there's always a downside, is that the doctors can't really tell how well I'm going to respond until later in the cycle because of the estrogen priming. So I could stim for a longer time than I normally would have without the priming, only to have the cycle canceled. We're gonna keep our fingers crossed that that doesn't happen. So one other thing that what happens is if the FSH is too high, it creates what they call dyssynchrony, which means one of the other follicles jumps out ahead of all of the others and is growing faster, taking up all the nutrients. In the IVF cycle, they want them to all kind of grow at the same rate, so that at the time of retrieval, they're all kind of ready. There is an antagonist that's giving to prevent ovulation while all of this is happening, but ideally, they're all going to come together, they're all going to be getting the same nutrients at the same time, and they're going to grow in harmony, in synchrony, instead of the dyssynchrony when one is larger than the other and it's taking up all of the nutrients. So hopefully that makes sense. That's what I found out about the estrogen priming. I'm looking forward to it. I think it's great, particularly because my FSH has been elevated the last two times. I am working on my diet. I am exercising, so I hope that it will naturally be lower, but it depends on if my estrogen is at the appropriate level during my luteal phase and if that inhibin is at the appropriate level. That ultimately impacts whether my FSH will be high. If that inhibin is not there to keep it in check, it's going to go sky high in the luteal phase, and then by the time we get around to cycle day 2 or cycle day 3, it's already high and it's already kind of causing chaos in my ovaries. So we want it all to be like calm and low and rise up together. And then we'll have monitoring throughout the cycle once we start the meds on cycle day 2 or cycle day 3. And as we introduce more of the hormones, that the body is responding well and is all of the eggs are coming together, they're maturing together. I know sometimes you guys probably see ladies who have on their, as they're being monitored, like one or two follicles is way ahead of the others and they're like hoping it'll catch up. Ideally, you don't want them to be too far apart, and that just typically helps with the outcome when it comes to egg retrieval. All right, ladies, so that's what I found out. If you guys have any questions or any input or you've gone through estrogen priming, let me know down below. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and remember to share it with everybody that you know. Infertility is nothing to be ashamed of. Let's talk about it. I will talk to you later. Bye. Baby dust to you all. I see the crystal raindrops fall, and the beauty of it all is when the sun comes shining through to make those rainbows in my mind.